Welcome back to Fantasy Football Today. I'm Jamie, that's Dave, that's Heath. We have the starts and sits that you need for week number four. And please, let's get the start of the week right for week number four. I'm hopeful for this one. The first three have gone absolutely rotten, but Jalen Hurts, he's gonna deliver, especially since he's excited about this game, taking on the Chiefs. I think we're gonna see some garbage time production. It's gonna matter. You know, you see the Chiefs are 7-point favorites on the road. Over-under expected to be over 50 points. So Jalen Hurts has been very good from a floor standpoint. It's a matter of where his ceiling will get to, and I think we're going to see one of his best performances of the season based on his rushing. He's averaging just a little shy of 60 yards per game on the ground. We've seen the Chiefs the last 2 weeks struggle with two quarterbacks, one in particular, Lamar Jackson, in week two, who went for over 100 yards on the ground and score a couple of touchdowns. So, Heath, you're on board. Sportsline's on board. Dave, what's your concern about Jalen Hurts this week?
Man, I hate having to do this because this is what happened in week two with Ben Roethlisberger. I just think that there are a lot of other quarterbacks that I would trust ahead of Jalen Hurts right now. I don't think he's playing great. I'm concerned about the offensive line. I am legit concerned about the coaching staff being overmatched in this game against Steve Spagnuolo and that Kansas City defense. And so if he's going to get it done, he laughed at that. The Chiefs fan laughed at that one. Look, I think he can. I think that floor is in place, getting somewhere between 20 and 23 fantasy points. I think there's a dozen quarterbacks I'd rather have, including Derek Carr, including Kirk Cousins, ahead of Jalen Hurts.
Tell him why he's wrong.
The funny thing is we have all these concerns about, can Jalen Hurts play better? I mean, he's the Chiefs. Maybe that will get him going. He's the number 9 quarterback in fantasy so far this season. Jalen Hurts' bad play is good enough to be a starting fantasy quarterback because of how much he runs. If he has a good game, he'll be top 3 this week.
We saw it in week 1. You know, so that's the type of production I'm hoping for this week, and I'm hoping for. That's all. I'll just leave it at that. Let's go. Right. Jalen Hurts, he's due. All right, let's go to some other starts for week number 4. For me, I'm going to go stick with the Eagles. I think Miles Sanders gets more than 2 carries. I think we're going to see him get back going a little bit on the ground against the Chiefs early in the game, and then Jalen Hurts takes over later in the game. Like what I saw from Zach Moss last week, targets are going to be available for Jalen Waddle and Jacoby Myers. And then we get to Corey Davis with the revenge game. 10 targets last week. I think we'll see Zach Wilson continue to lean on him. That's still a weakness of the Titans' defense, is their secondary, so hopefully Davis exploits it and can be at least a number 3 fantasy wide receiver. Let's go now to Dave's starts for week number 4. And Dave, you're going all in on Chuba Hubbard, expecting him to play well this week.
I don't know if all in is the correct term, but I do think he's going to be good as a number 2 fantasy running back. I like his chances to get 15-plus touches, and I like his potential in the passing game. We've seen the Panthers, and granted, they've got Christian McCaffrey, but they've leaned on their running backs quite a bit to catch passes, and we did see it from Chubbard last week after McCaffrey left the game early against Houston. It's a 24.7% target share for the running backs in the Carolina offense. I think Hubbard does fine with it, and I think Cordarrelle Patterson continues to pick up targets as well. Matt Ryan's been checking it down a ton. Patterson is starting to make inroads on getting even on playing time with Mike Davis. I think he's the one I'd rather start in PPR.
Sam Darnold used to have D. Arnold. Now he's got Chubbard, as you called him.
I called him Chubbard?
He did.
I'm just trying to shorten
it. Hey, listen, we like
you said you want to get through the show fast, right?
Like
shorten his name to one thing.
We like it.
Back
we
to
like
you,
it.
Jeisenberg.
All right, Heath, your starts for week number 4. You got Kirk Cousins, Mike Davis, David Montgomery, Michael Pittman, and Dalton Schultz. So start with Schultz and then get into Michael Pittman, because Dave does not like Michael Pittman, as he has him as a sit this week. So tell me about Dalton Schultz building off of the game last week. We scored 2 touchdowns.
Yeah, I mean, he's really been decent as far as a tight end, 2 out of 3 games this season. And we've seen the Cowboys each of the past 2 years, they've finished the year with a borderline number 1 tight end. 2 years ago, it was Jason Witten. Last year, it was Dalton Schultz. I thought coming into this year, it would be Blake Jarwin. Schultz is playing ahead of Jarwin. So I expect that Schultz is just going to be in this range, hopefully, the rest of the year. Now, I want to be clear, if you're ranked 11th at tight end, you might score 4 fantasy points, or you might score a touchdown. Like, that's the way basically everybody outside of the top 8 is. Michael Pittman's a different story, at least for me. He's got 24 targets over his last 2 games. It's not a great matchup against the Dolphins. You know who's not a great matchup? The Rams. He had 8 catches for 123 yards against the Rams. I think Michael Pittman is the clear number 1 wide receiver for the Colts and a borderline number 2 this week.
He did a good job exploiting that zone defense against LA. The Dolphins do use a lot more man, and I think that's going to hurt Carson Wentz. This Colts offensive line has allowed the 2nd most pressures. 36.2% of the time Carson Wentz is under duress. That means his targets are going to be off, and that means that Pittman won't be able to come through despite the good target volume that he's gotten. So not only do you have to hope that those targets continue to be there for Michael Pittman, but that he also catches a bunch of them, including in the end zone. There was one play last week where it was really close. Wentz was just off target. That's my worry when it comes to Pittman.
and stay in that same game, Myles Gaskin, you're also a little bit concerned about him.
He's got zero carries inside the 10-yard line this year. I don't know what the Dolphins are thinking. They believe that Malcolm Brown is the answer inside the 10, inside the 5. It hasn't been the answer. And he's also splitting work in the two-minute offense. This is a completely different look from what we saw in the preseason and in Dolphins practice. I'd like to see Gaskin get that opportunity, but until we actually see it, he's going to be a flex for me.
All right, so we'll see how things go for Gaskin. It is a favorable game script for the Dolphins, and he did have 13 carries last week, but I'm with you, Dave. You can try and get away from him. It's probably the right move to make. Let's go to the sits now for you, Heath. You got Kenyon Drake, Tyson Williams, Will Fuller, Chase Claypool, and Dallas Goedert. Talk to me about Tyson Williams and Chase Claypool, because you got two guys here that are interesting. Williams disappointed last week. Claypool, we know about the Steelers' injuries. We got into the start of the show, but just reiterate your concern potentially about him this week.
Yeah, I think with Tyson, it's just the fact that it's a bad matchup and he got 5 carries last week. We don't have any idea at this point who the starting or lead running back for the Baltimore Ravens is, and they are not as run heavy as they've been in past years. And they're still run heavy compared to the rest of the league, but a lot of those runs, 38% so far this year, go to Lamar Jackson. That's not necessarily something new. So I think you have a ceiling with Tyson Williams if you hope you get him 13 or 14 carries against a very good run defense. And the floor, well, we saw that last week. Chase Claypool is kind of dependent on who's healthy, but I don't know that I like him either way. If Deontay Johnson and Juju come back, then I'm definitely out on Claypool as anything more than a low-end number 3 wide receiver. But even if Johnson or Juju is back or is out, I'm not sure he's not going to have the worst matchup of the Steelers wide receivers. I don't think there's any chance he's going to have time to get down the field with the pressure the Packers are going to put on Ben Roethlisberger.
It's frustrating because the targets were great last week, but you just have to be concerned about the matchup also with Jaire Alexander on the other side of the field. Sits for me, Damien Harris is the one that makes me the most nervous, just looking at the matchup against the Buccaneers and not knowing what his role is going to be if they're chasing points. Will he have a bigger role in the passing game without James White there, or will it be more of a frustrating situation where we're seeing a lot more of Brandon Bolden? So Damien Harris has been a good number 2 running back, better in non-PPR than PPR, but he's somebody that I would like to avoid in week number 4. Want more of the Fantasy Football Today podcast and nonstop year-round fantasy advice? It's simple. Hit the subscribe button and hang with us all throughout the year.